Our next reading is from Luke chapter 22. And he came out and went, as was his custom, to the Mount of Olives, and the disciples followed him. And when he came to the place, he said to them, "Pray that you may not enter into temptation." And he withdrew from them about a stone's throw, and knelt down and prayed, saying, "Father, if you are willing, remove this cup from me. Nevertheless, not my will, but yours be done." And there appeared to him an angel from heaven, strengthening him. And being in agony, he prayed more earnestly, and his sweat became like great drops of blood falling down to the ground. And when he rose from prayer, he came to the disciples and found them sleeping for sorrow. And he said to them, "Why are you sleeping? Rise and pray, that you may not enter into temptation." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Grace, mercy, and peace be to you from God our Father and the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. As we come to this Garden of Gethsemane today, as we come to pray with Jesus, to be with Jesus, and to do his will, we come with those disciples who were charged to do the same. And there we see, if we manage to stay awake, Jesus struggling in prayer to do the Father's will. I mean, Jesus' prayer might sound simple, certainly brief as far as Luke tells it. "Father, if you are willing, remove this cup from me. Nevertheless, not my will, but yours be done." That's a short prayer. Though it might be simple, at least in its words, though it might be short, Luke also goes to great pains to make clear that it is a prayer that Jesus spent quite a while praying. A short prayer prayed for a long time. A simple prayer prayed with apparently great agony. Just like in our own lives, doing the will of God is sometimes a simple sounding matter, but not a simple feeling matter. "Oh yeah, I just need to do God's will. That's easy. It's really clear in the Bible. That means I just need to change the things I do for fun or how I behave around my friends or where I work. Or I need to have that difficult conversation, which I've been putting off." Maybe it's not so simple. Easy to say, hard to mean, harder to even do, maybe. And Luke does his best to make that clear. For Jesus, these simple, short words were prayed in agony, even more earnestly, we're told. And then we get the curious description that Jesus' sweat became like drops of blood, great drops of blood falling to the ground. And I imagine most of you have heard that this is indeed a real medical condition, that people in great stress and anxiety can literally sweat blood. But it just goes to show the difficulty, the anguish, the earnestness with which Jesus prayed this prayer. He really meant it. "If you are willing, remove this cup from me. Nevertheless, not my will, but yours be done." Before we continue with the story, I'd like to pause here and just make a really brief note of application. This is counterintuitive as I say it, but Jesus' anguish in prayer should be a relief for us. It means that we're not alone when we struggle with God's will for our own life. It means that it's okay, even normal, when we pray simple prayers and we struggle to mean them, when we struggle to wrestle with the import of them. When they're prayers of few words, that's okay too. It means it's okay, even normal, for our prayers to last a long time and not get very far. It means it's okay, even normal, to acknowledge the tension between our wills and God's will as a Christian. It's certainly okay, even normal, to say, I trust you. Not my will, but yours be done. Why is it okay? Why is it normal? Well, it's because Jesus did. Jesus struggled. Jesus prayed simple prayers sometimes, as if the Lord's Prayer isn't a good enough indication that simple prayers are okay by itself. But the point is, don't worry if you feel sick to your stomach. Don't worry if you have sleepless nights as you pray. Don't worry if you're sweating blood as you pray. Well, okay, maybe we should draw back a little bit. If you are sweating blood, you might want to go see somebody. But again, the point is, in Jesus we have a vindication of sorts for our own struggles with God's will in our life. Struggling with God's will is okay. You might even say it's what it means to be human. But doing God's will, well, that's the rub, isn't it? That's the difficult part. That's where the rubber has to hit the road. And that's why these simple prayers are not so simple. Doing God's will sounds simple, but it's not. It can be lonely. It can be unintuitive. It can be unpopular. Sometimes it even requires sacrifice. Like giving up the things you enjoy, doing something you don't want to do, loving someone you don't want to love. It can be hard. But for all of us and for our human weakness, our human struggle with God's will, this encounter between Jesus and the disciples in the Garden of Gethsemane, this prayer which Jesus prays in this garden is good news. For the disciples, we're told, were encouraged by Jesus to stay and pray. Pray that you might not fall into temptation. It's a simple task. Something you should be able to hang on to. Something that you shouldn't fall asleep doing, presumably. But of course they failed. As so many humans do when they're given simple tasks by God, they failed. They fell asleep. And though Jesus gives them a prayer to pray, which is straight out of the Lord's Prayer itself, something they should already know, we know that not only did they fall asleep in this moment, but they would face considerable temptations in the coming hours as Jesus is arrested and beaten. They would succumb to considerable temptations in the coming hours. But they didn't know this. They thought it was just another night of prayer with Jesus. Jesus' rhetoric, his teaching has changed a little bit in the last couple of days. He's doing things a little different. He's told us some things that sound rather concerning. But this is, as the text just told us, something that Jesus did often. He went to the mountain to pray often. And yet whether they realized the urgency of this particular prayer, pray that you might not fall into temptation, they do. They fall asleep. They fail to heed God's will for their life. They sorrow the simple command is broken. And yet, in Jesus, we see the exact opposite. Though they didn't do God's will due to their own human weakness, in Jesus we see every evidence of his strength. Jesus obeyed God's command and intervened for these disciples for all of their faults. He spent this time in prayer for them. We don't hear it in the prayer which Luke gives us, but if you flip to John 17 and read the high priestly prayer, you see Jesus praying powerfully for the sake of these gathered disciples who have so fully failed him. He prays for their unity and their witness, their preservation in the midst of the coming trials which they know nothing about. He prays for what they should have prayed for in the first place, that they might not enter into temptation. Jesus knows they will fail, and so he does what he must and what they could not for them. He doesn't fall asleep, though his prayers are certainly more difficult. We're not told by Luke that any of the disciples are sweating blood. And when he finds them asleep, he's not railing against them. He doesn't go on a rampage. He simply encourages them to resume the prayers that they should have been doing in the first place. Pray with what little time is left. The hour is coming. And as we know, immediately after the story, the hour is here. In all of this, all that Jesus does, he's doing God's will, doing what the disciples proved they could not. And he wasn't done either. For we know that Jesus continued to do God's will. He continued to say, "Not my will, but yours be done," as he suffered and died, and of course, as he rose again. All of this for faltering, weak disciples who couldn't even stay awake. And of course, all of this for you and me too. In this garden, this place of strength, we see the power and strength of our Lord and Savior so clearly. We see that God's love is stronger than our weakness. We see in Christ that even in our weakness, in the places where we are weakest, God is strong. We see that we can entrust our weakness in prayer to Jesus, for he enters those places of our weakness and makes them a place of his strength. We see that we can entrust our weakness in temptation to Jesus, for we know that he was tempted in every way that we are tempted, and yet he did not sin. We can entrust our weakness and temptation to Jesus, for he was patient with the disciples in all of their failings, in all of their temptations, in their inability to even acknowledge and see that temptation which Jesus presented to them oh so clearly. And we know that we can entrust even our weakness in sin to Jesus. For it was God's will which he accomplished, God's will that he die for our sins, died to save us from our sins, and to bring us to everlasting life. Whatever your weakness in this Lenten season, whatever has you penitent here before our Heavenly Father, know that Jesus is strong. In it, in your weakness in particular, and rest now in his strength. And as you do, may the very peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen.